Hey, thanks for coming. So I was going to show you a cartoon, which is kind of a civil liberties cartoon that keeps on coming up again and again, which shows a US government official holding a box that says control of internet speech. And the guy behind the counter is saying, "How would you like this wrapped, sir?" And the packaging that's on offer is anti-terrorism or protecting children. So in the case of the digital economy bill and age verification, we're very much in the latter excuse for curtailing our civil liberties. And the thinness of that excuse becomes more revealed the more you look into it. So, as has been introduced, I make porn. I'm also a member of Org, actually, and have been for about 10 years. But my introduction to the age verification policy started when my fetish website, I mean, a queer porn website called Dreams of Spanking, was investigated by ATVOD, the Authority for TV on Demand, which used to be the online porn regulator. In 2015, shortly before new laws came in late 2014, which changed what kind of online porn was legal to publish, imposing the BBFC classification guidelines on the internet for the first time. So I got into quite a lot of trouble for the fact that my films were not classifiable. And one of the things that they found me in breach of, as well as having prohibited content under the BBFC's definition, was making my material available to under 18s because my site accepted debit cards. And at the time, ATVOD was of the opinion that the only way you could stop under 18s from looking at online porn was to have it protected by credit card access only. So I appealed the decision after having to live through my business being taken offline for 10 months, which was pretty disruptive and quite unpleasant. And appealing with the help of Myles and Backlash, who are an organization that lobby on behalf of issues around sexual freedom, put me in a really good position to reply to the consultation that came out last year, pretty much exactly a year ago, in April 2016, which was issued by the Department of Culture, Media and Sport about the policy of imposing age verification on online porn. So they put it to public consultation. I was on holiday, and my partner, who was in the audience, was extremely forbearing while I spent most of our 2-week holiday researching why age verification might not be the wisest course of action, and putting together a 10,000-word response, which I duly sent to them, which was really, really informative. I learned a lot. For example, the evidence that was cited by the DCMS in support of the policy for age verification really does not stand up to academic scrutiny. I think Miles is going to go into more detail about some of the ways in which that's true, but I was absolutely astonished to discover that the government's own overview of the evidence, which they had themselves, Ofcom, had put together in 2005, which was a kind of review of all of the academic studies around whether young people are harmed by looking at sexual images, found that there was absolutely no robust evidence that they were. And moreover, there was quite strong evidence to the contrary. For example, studies from the USA, Japan, and Denmark quite clearly show that greater exposure and greater availability of sexual imagery is strongly correlated with lower rates of teenage pregnancy, lower rates of teenage sexual assault, lower rates of STI transmission. And pretty much the only way in which young people accidentally seeing porn before they're 18 has any evidence for it being a bad thing is if you take the fact that they're less likely to then get married as being a harm, which is probably not a very rational point of view. Nonetheless, the government seem to be convinced. They are taking it as granted, as a kind of an accepted premise in all of the debates around the age verification policy since then, that young people are harmed by sexual imagery being available to them. And so the lack of sort of rational, evidence-based understanding is really quite remarkable. So AV has problems in its premise. There are problems around privacy, which the Open Rights Group have been talking about in great detail over the last year, and Miles is going to dip into as well. There's also quite a few social problems with making people age verify in order to look at online porn. I mean, issues around social exclusion and classism, which take us back to, you know, the trial, the obscenity trial for Lady Chatterley's Lover, where, you know, the famous line, would you want your wife or servants to look at it, really does seem to be repeated in the idea that unless you are financially secure enough to have a credit rating or a credit card, unless you are domestically secure enough to have your migration papers in order, proof of address, you know, unless you can get a mobile phone contract, you're not allowed to look at porn. You're not considered to be as adult as people who perhaps have these things. And so, you know, in its very concept, age verification marginalizes people who are already at the margins and creates this double standard of adults who are sort of adult enough, have enough social status to be able to look at dirty images, and adults, including perhaps transgender people or domestic violence survivors who may not be, you know, willing for very good reason to share identifying or address details online, are not. So, I won my appeal, thanks to the help of Miles and Backlash, which was a glorious moment that lasted about 5 minutes last summer before the Digital Economy Bill was tabled to Parliament before the summer recess and threatens to criminalise me all over again. So we've been very busy then since then campaigning against it, specifically against Section 3, which covers the age verification policy. In October, we organised an event called the Kink Olympics, XXX, which you might have heard of, where we got together speakers from civil liberties organisations, including Org, queer community leaders, academics, sex educators, in front of Parliament to talk to a bunch of kinky weirdos about why consensual adult sex should not be criminalised. I also worked around that time with the Digital Policy Alliance, who are a kind of government group and representatives from the sort of more mainstream porn kind of trade associations, ended up submitting evidence to them during the period where you could submit evidence to the House of Commons around the Digital Economy Bill, talking in detail specifically about the problems with the definition of pornography in the bill, and the problems around the amendment that was being introduced to impose the BBFC classification guidelines, which the AVMS had already done and I'd already been, you know, caught by, to the internet again. So just to briefly fill you in on the problem with that, the BBFC have got a classification called R18, which is the most extreme classification you can give. It has an awful long list of things that are not classifiable as R18. They're considered too extreme to be classified. Now, that list is meant to be based on what's legally considered obscene, which goes back to the Obscene Publications Act, a 1950s law, which has had various cases since then. And the Crown Prosecution Service are meant to maintain guidance, which keeps being updated in response to the case law, on the grounds that what is considered obscene tends to change from decade to decade. And when the OPA was passed, it was illegal to even have gay sex, never mind film it. So our understanding of what is obscene these days is somewhat different. Unfortunately, the CPS guidance hasn't been updated for several years, certainly not since Miles got a couple of acquittals under the OPA for content, which is still on the BBFC's prohibited content guidance. So just to summarise, the BBFC still refused to classify material which is legally not obscene in the UK and which is, according to the case law, absolutely legal to distribute. You will not be prosecuted for distributing it. So this includes things like extreme BDSM, water sports, fisting. You're probably familiar with the list from various media around this. Now, for a long time during the process of the Digital Economy Bill through Parliament, it looked very much as if this list was going to be enshrined in the bill, to the extent that since the BBFC were going to be the new online porn regulator, since ATVOD had been folded in a puff of embarrassment shortly after my appeal win, not that I'm claiming credit for that, but it was rather satisfying, the BBFC would have the power to not only fine sites who are displaying prohibited content, but actually block them at an ISP level from being visible in the UK, even though that content was perfectly legal in the UK. They also were going to be given the power, well, are being given the power to ISP block any sites that don't comply with the age verification requirement. So we're talking about an extremely heavy lock, curtailment of our civil liberties. So we've been campaigning against it. We submitted evidence. Miles and I submitted some evidence jointly in October about why this was a terrible idea, why it wasn't justified by the evidence. I joined Backlash at the start of this year, accepted the role of spokesperson, and when the bill passed to the Lords, we've been doing some lobbying of the Lords, the House of Lords, before the second debate, targeting peers that we thought would be likely to be sympathetic or interested, and emphasising three arguments. Firstly, the lack of evidence supporting an age verification policy. Secondly, the threat to privacy. And thirdly, the threat to free expression, particularly in as much as the BBFC guidelines are involved in the bill and the ISP blocking is being given as a potential sanction. So since then, I've been following the progress of the bill through the Lords, which has been extremely laborious because I'm not a lawyer. But it's just been passed for a royal assent after the third debate in the Lords. And there have been one or two partial victories, which I think those of us who have been campaigning against it can claim credit for. Specifically, my personal bugbear, because it's been affecting my work, The BBFC guidelines for prohibited content are no longer going to be the benchmark for what content is going to be enforced by the regulator. Instead, they've changed the wording very recently, only a couple of weeks ago, to be the kind of, you may be familiar with this in 2009, the extreme pornography definition, if you remember the extreme porn legislation in the Criminal Justice and Immigration Act. Which Myles is going to give you a fuller definition of, but suffice to say it's a much narrower list of banned content than the BBFC guidelines, and it is in this frustrating situation of being completely out of date with the case law. So we can claim that as a partial victory, that sites like mine, which depict consensual fetish content, are much less likely to be criminalised by the bill and much less likely to be ISP blocked or fined if we display, even with age verification, that sort of kind of niche fetish content. However, it is not, the war has not been won, although that tiny battle has been. The bill is still egregious on questions of user privacy. I think Myles is going to talk more about that. The ability to appeal to an independent body if you've been enforced by the BBFC is fairly lacking. At the moment, there isn't a robust appeals process in place. And the age verification providers themselves, who are not government bodies, the government aren't providing an age verification system that they're saying this is robust and we've checked it and it's secure and you can use it. They farmed this out to a bunch of for-profit companies who have pitched various technologies, most of whom don't really know that much about how porn or privacy works, and are basically letting them compete in the market. So it's pretty outrageous that there is no regulation of what AV companies are able to provide age verification in the bill. The regulator is not going to be regulating the AV companies. The other problem is that ISP blocking is still going to be the ultimate sanction for any sites that don't comply. So let's just have a quick look at how age verification is going to work in practice. You are going to visit a porn website. It might be a free tube site. It might be a sex blog, which hosts adverts and therefore makes money. It might be a video website, a photo website. Both are covered by the bill. If you want to look at any free previews that include anything that would be classified as 18 or above by the BBFC, so any nudity, any depiction of sexual acts, then you will need to verify that you are over 18. Now, ideally, you'll be given a choice of which AV provider you want to do this via. But that isn't actually mandatory, so you might only be given one choice and it might not be a great one. So the various options that you might be given include using your credit rating, giving them your access to your Experian credit rating so that they can verify you're over 18, giving them your mobile phone number so that they can check with your mobile phone provider whether or not you're over 18 if you've already shown them ID, giving them your Facebook login, at which point they would have access to all of your private messages and run some sort of machine learning process in order to guess whether or not you're over 18. Basically, a lot of these techniques involve the sharing of an awful lot more data than is strictly necessary. And there is absolutely no law in this bill against the age verification provider retaining that data, sharing it, selling it, trading it, or otherwise using it for their own purposes. So one of the age verification solutions which I've been made aware of is the tube sites is one of the big issues that the government wants to deal with in this bill, right? The fact that there's a whole bunch of free porn that you don't have to pay to look at, and actually it's kind of the, you know, lowest common denominator of what's trickled down over the last 15 years of internet pornography. So it represents a pretty sleazy selection, and it's all edited like out of context without any information about the performer or welfare, and often with very kind of stigmatizing language, like, you know, slurs, using the kind of keywords to try and attract people's attention. So it's not a great way to look at porn if you're interested in, you know, being an ethical consumer. And so if kids are going to look at it, then it's probably going to give them a slightly weird idea of what porn is and what sex is. So MindGeek own most of the cheap sites. They're a multi-million dollar international company. They also own browsers and various other porn production companies. So they currently have a monopoly on porn distribution via the cheap sites and on porn production via the big production companies. They kind of dominate the online porn traffic quite significantly. So I think they realized quite early on that they were going to need to get in on this or be destroyed. And so they have been involved with the crafting of this legislation for a few years. And they have invested millions of dollars in building an age verification software solution, which they are going to undercut everyone else with, so that any porn site that wants to be able to afford AV is going to be in their interest to use MindGeek's solution. The way MindGeek's solution is going to work is you go to, you know, RedTube or something, and you need to look at it, so you verify your age using one of these many methods, and then they give you a login, which you can then reuse without having to re-verify on any porn site that uses their system. Now, you can imagine how much data that is going to give MindGeek if they're going to have stats on what people click on, what porn sites people click on, what they pay for. Pretty much, once you've got a MindGeek login, you are going to be giving them your entire web browsing history because they're going to be able to track every time you log into anything. And the ensuing database is going to be enormously valuable to them for marketing purposes and working out what to sell and buy next and build next. But it's also going to be extraordinarily ripe for data leaks, hacks, sabotage. I mean, they've had hack after hack after hack. Like, MindGeek's data is not secure. And we've seen the devastating effect that adult database leaks can have with the Ashley Madison case, which resulted in suicides. So this is no trivial issue. Behind the scenes, at the site owner level, so this is people like me, the economic burden of age verification is going to have a significant impact on the porn industry in the UK. Basically, the way that it works, porn economics, is that you receive a number of visitors each day, that's your traffic, and a tiny percentage of that, at most 0.1%, but for most people it's kind of in the 0.01% level, will convert to paying customers. So if you have to pay for every site visitor, let's say you're paying, you're not paying MindGeek's 5p a visitor, you're paying maybe the mobile phone, you know, age verification system, which is like 10p a visitor. My site, since it reopened, hasn't had much traffic, maybe 3,000 visitors a day. But I make £1,000 a month, and I cannot afford £300 a day in order to age verify all of my traffic. It's an order of magnitude beyond what any small business is going to be able to afford. So by imposing this economic burden, and there's almost a punitive flavour in the way that the Department of Culture, Media and Sport, the government, are demanding that pornography providers kind of bear the cost of this. It's like, we need to make them pay for the fact that they're profiting from making porn available on the internet. That attitude is pretty much entirely going to wipe out all of the small businesses, the kind of niche sites, the DIY, one porn performer or camera at home shooting her own clips, a couple making the porn they want to see in their bedroom, people making fetish porn, feminist porn, queer porn, anything that's kind of homegrown and do-it-yourself. None of those sites are going to be able to afford the cost of age verification. So the only sites that are going to survive are going to be the MindGeek sites, you know, the big fish, the lowest common denominator sites who are producing very heteronormative, very mainstream porn, which is going to be widely popular. And the thriving ecosystem of porn, which is interesting and diverse and kind of contributing to the cultural diversity and, you know, breadth, and providing, you know, a better range of porn that we might actually want young people to be able to find when they're ready for it, those are going to be the ones who are going to be put out of business by this bill. I am not intending to keep my site open because I simply can't afford to. So what can we do about this? Well, it's a bit late to write to our MPs. The bill has just been passed by the Lords and is now at the stage of getting royal assent. But my suggestions are, firstly, pay for your porn. I mean, I would say that, so I'm biased, and you can take this with a pinch of salt. But if you visit a site, that site is going to be paying for your visit. And if you like it and you become a customer, then the porn that you like might still be able to afford to stay open. Secondly, use a VPN. If you're not visiting from a UK IP address, then savvy site owners who have got a geo-block in place in order to get around this will not need to age verify you, and you might be able to get away without paying. You should be doing this anyway as a result of the Snoopers Charter, which I'm sure you all know about. Finally, it would be very much appreciated if you could support financially, if you can, organisations like the Open Rights Group and Backlash. And I'm going to take this opportunity to mention the fact that Myles and I both have Patreon accounts, which we use to fund our unpaid volunteer activism. Especially in the last year, we've spent months and months of our time on this. So I think that's all I've got time for. And I'm going to pass over to Myles. Should we do questions at the end?
It's really a very
okay, yeah, sure.
One of the things that the meetings that I went to about this were really concerned about was linking your login to the person so you don't have the older brother sharing his login with his younger brother and so forth.
Right.
The system you described for my peak doesn't seem to cover that.
Right, exactly. I mean, you maybe verify with, a QR code on your phone, but or scanning your debit card or whatever, but once you've got that username and password, you could totally share it with someone.
So it's really not fit.
No, it's not. No.
That might be something to campaign on.
Well, yes, there's lots of things we can campaign on, although it's a little bit late to stop this bill passing now. We're going to have to, you know, take other approaches at this point. But yeah, it doesn't. But then age verification doesn't stop kids looking at porn anyway. You know, I mean, kids know how to use VPNs. They're more tech savvy than most grown-ups. So, yeah. All right.
Just a quickie. Yeah. Right. Yeah, Adam Scarborough, campaign against censorship, basically. Articles for them. Basically, I think the contradiction here is they basically staring us in the face. These are acts that are legal in reality, but are illegal on celluloid. So there's one big contradiction there, which surely is a great campaigning vehicle.
So are you talking about the prohibited content?
Prohibited content.
Yeah, well, thankfully we've managed to get that taken out of the bill. It's been replaced by the extreme porn definition. And I think the extreme porn, Myles is going to talk about this in more detail, but everything in that definition is, I think, illegal to do.
Sorry?
In the extreme porn definition.
That's the high
So that's so you're absolutely correct, and we have made that point, and we have actually won on that point, which is a massive relief.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
Just a quickie. There was an attempt in America to introduce a similar system, which was thrown out by the courts as being a breach of the First Amendment. Was that more or less where they got these the same system?
I think they're actually modelling this on Germany's system. But all the rhetoric is like, oh, the UK is a world leader in child internet safety and we're the first to pioneer this and everyone else is going to follow us. So they haven't... Well, they haven't acknowledged the US as an inspiration. Mm-hmm. Germany have been successfully doing it for a few years.
Oh, I see. But is it the same system?
No. I don't know exactly how it works in Germany. One of my German friends told me you have to take your passport to the post office and get, like, a verification code. Yeah. All right, let's move on. I'm going to hand the mic over to Myles, and we can have more questions at the end.
If you've got any questions for me, points of clarification, etc., please, please ask. Right, not working. Okay, well, I wanted to start, as I often do, from a slightly different perspective. I want to take you back to 1976. Because this seems to be a core moment in time. Because the Sex Pistols on Bill Grundy. 1976, the Sex Pistols' popular beat Combo Malad appeared on the Bill Grundy show before the watershed in the afternoon and swore quite profusely at Bill Grundy. You'll see on the left is the Daily Mirror's headline, The Filth and the Fury. The one that I found most interesting, though, is the centre picture of the television. Because according to certain reports in the laudable Red Top publications, a viewer who saw this with his children was so offended by the Sex Pistols swearing on television that he actually kicked his own television set. Now, that's exactly how I felt in 2013, which I'm calling year zero for porn based on the 77 year zero for punk. Now, this is an editorial from The Guardian, and if you can just read the first paragraph at the top. So, internet pornography is sometimes abusive and often violent. Now, this is really interesting because this is the moment I wanted to punch my MacBook. Because this is not the original article, because it was later amended. The original article said internet pornography is abusive and violent. So, sorry for the person who works in this publication. I hope this is embarrassing for them. But I did a small amount of writing for Guardian Law, and I saw this editorial, which went online before the print edition came out, which was the moment at which I wanted to punch my MacBook. And I tried to contact my editor at Guardian Law, saying, look, you're obviously entitled to run any stories that you want, but don't you think that this is in direct conflict with my ethos? Now, without speculating too heavily as to who wrote this particular editorial, I understand from friends and colleagues, that, and also my editor when she was still talking to me, that the Guardian actually had a crisis meeting that morning. And as a consequence of the crisis meeting, the words sometimes and often were inserted in this article. So there is a successful campaign. Internet pornography is now sometimes abusive and often violent. But you see, the interesting thing to me is the source, you know, a left-leaning newspaper with an editorial giving this issue almost out of nowhere at the time, and linking it in with various other cultural trends in order to suggest that there is a link between the consumption of pornography and other societal ills. The solution at the bottom of the article, which I've just emphasised, is the de facto bar preventing UK credit cards being used on such porn sites. Now, I really, that moment, apart from the fact I didn't punch my MacBook, I started smoking again almost immediately after a 2-month giving up effort. I mailed the org list, which I had lurked on for years. I mailed the org law list and said, look, I'm really worried about this. I think that filtering, age verification and various other pernicious activities will come to pass as a consequence of this impulse. And 2015, the NSPCC issued a survey, and you'll see the quote from the bottom, which I couldn't find the original survey for reasons that I will make clear. But the NSPCC conducted this survey, the conclusion of which was that 12 to 13 year olds were worried, attempted 12 to 13 year olds were worried that they were addicted to pornography, which again may seem a logical occurrence, etc., etc. I'm just emphasizing the article because the conflation between pornography and marriage, etc., from boy who is 12 to 15, can he make his mind up? But it's those kind of broad moralistic assertions which allow us to identify child protection imperative as the only imperative. And I say that as someone who's worked for the NSPCC, and I will go on, and have gone on record to say that I think this was an absolute disgrace because, I'll show you, immediately this report came to light, then Culture Secretary Sajid Javid responded by suggesting credit cards as the means of age verification. Now, at the time, again, you notice credit cards again, children over 14 could be added to an adult guarantor's account. Personally, I would suggest that the bottom line is the most likely for anyone who desperately wants to acquire material, which is begging, borrowing, or stealing an adult's credit card, for those of you who can't see it. So, Sajid Javid stated that. However, A few days later, the actual original NSPCC study was essentially called out. It was created by this market research group, OnePoll, and from their own website, they described themselves as mega popular, which we just love. I'm going to put that in my Twitter bio. Mega popular Myles Jackman runs polls for the press. I mean, fun questions about celebs and your love life. And the there was a very good article in Vice by Frankie Mullen who deconstructed it forensically. But I found this quote from Marketing Today on OnePoll at the time. And it simply says that the what is reported as scientific is not in fact genuine research at all, but dishonest marketing concocted by PR firms. So, Professor Clarissa Smith, who is a professor of sexual culture and media, I think Sunderland at the moment, basically deconstructed the methodology and said that it was ridiculous to have a parent who had gone to a site like Money Saving Expert, thought I can earn a few quid getting doing some online polls, sitting their child with them and go, are you worried about pornography, little child? Surprisingly receiving the answer, what do you think, Mum? So, yeah, there is obviously a serious bleed there. As she's described it, the dimensions of parent-pleasing there are horrific, and it certainly seems incredibly dubious. But this report and these statistics have repeatedly appeared in the discourse from the initial moment with Javid through to the to debates and reports, both in the Lords and in the Commons. So, 2015, the Conservative Party manifesto, I forget now how many pages it is, but a reasonably dense document, a single line is interpreted as a binding promise. We will stop children's exposure to harmful sexualized content online. And then it bifurcates by requiring age verification for access to all sites containing pornographic material and age rating for all music video. Now, while I'm not entirely keen on an 8-year-old watching the Nine Inch Nails video for Happiness and Slavery, which, if you haven't seen it, is Bob Flanagan disappearing, shall we say, in fairly intense ways, I'm slightly concerned about the conflation. I'm slightly concerned about going around art galleries and sticking 18 stickers on Colbert paintings of vaginas, etc., etc. So again, you see the censorious instinct kicks in. Okay, I'm going to kick now to today. Obviously not today. That's some fine beardage there, I feel, from some 1880 Mancunian police officers. And I really like the gentleman at the back, but there you go. So we are now up to the current day. What I'd like to do now is just really pick up from where Pandora was talking and just define what the law will be, as much as we can understand the digital economy bill, around pornography. So what is? Previously, we had been speculating what would be acceptable and what would not be acceptable. So this is the latest definition that was incorporated by amendment in the Lords, if I remember correctly. Previously, they talked about prohibited material. They've now adopted the phrase extreme pornographic material. If you see the bold at the very bottom, that comes from the offence in section 63 of the Criminal Justice and Immigration Act 2008 of extreme pornography. Now, the only thing I really agree with here is the definition of pornography, because it's very difficult, like from whichever perspective you come, to try and define pure, in inverted commas, pornography as opposed to art or erotica or sexual iconography. So it's claimed to be material that's produced solely or principally for the purposes of sexual arousal, which often in itself creates some problems. So I often deal with cases to do with sort of Japanese style manga anime type material, and single frames are then charged as offensive by the Crown Prosecution Service. Now, that individual frame is often part of a broader narrative. So you imagine a comic book, one frame out of nine on a page. If you took one out and said, well, that's clearly extreme pornography, if it's part of a broader narrative, is it produced solely or principally for the purposes of sexual arousal? So we get some really complicated issues coming in almost immediately. Also flag in the part two, I hope you can see at the bottom, the last line, very subjective language for law of the material has to be grossly offensive disgusting or otherwise an obscene character. And obviously that brings up all of the questions of, well, to whom? The language of disgust is so subjective and individual. You know, if I were to poll you all with 40 different things, probably there would be so much variety in the room as to what individuals found disgusting. So it's a very poor test at law, in my opinion. Okay, there are three parts to the test for extreme pornography. This will apply to the digital economy bill. So as Pandora was saying earlier, previously the BBFC's guidelines on restricted 18, R18 category material were the strongest material you could sell via DVD, and there was the intention to create that parity between what you could buy in a shop and what you could buy on the internet. So now, this will apply. The BBFC's guidelines previously, as many of you will probably know, essentially prohibited things, as the gentleman there suggested, I think it was, that are legal to do. So again, very problematic that if an activity is legal to perform, why should the presence of a camera turn a legal act into an illegal representation? Just off the top of my head, fisting and water sports were two of those. So fisting, vaginal, anal, perfectly legal to perform, very common activities, and yet you can't film it. And being in possession of that means that you are likely to a maximum of 3 years in custody. That is for being in possession of it. That is not for having uploaded it to a website, but the same act might apply for all consumers. Anyway, there are three tests in the Act. Again, the image is pornographic. I hope we've covered that on the definition. Grossly offensive, disgusting, or otherwise an obscene character. And it must portray in an explicit and realistic way. The realism test is an interesting one. It was essentially there to show that it must be a literal interpretation of a human. So in other words, a line drawing at the time was exempt as not being realistic. The example given in the Commons, as I'm sure you'll all identify with, was that of the portrait of Leda and the Swan. However, this was then obviated entirely by another piece of legislation the next year that went, oh yeah, line drawings, we're going to make them illegal too. And we got the prohibited images clauses in the Coroners and Justice Act. So again, a total erosion of freedom of expression, in my opinion, with, in the case of line drawings, absolutely no harm. So you could argue that pornography that is a visual representation that is accurate may have harmful effects. It's never been proved. Even the government paper that Pandora mentioned, the white paper from 2005, explicitly said that they couldn't find any link to pornography and actual tangible harm or offending, brackets, even though they were looking, which is pretty accurate, because of course the legislation passed without that. But of course, a line drawing, that who's harmed? A pencil, a piece of lead? I don't understand. Anyway, those are the tests. This is what is verboten, and they're in five categories. So an act which threatens a person's life, again, intended to capture certain types of material around asphyxia, etc. But in reality, it's so broadly drafted as to be, I've said, if I'm naked and smoking a cigarette, is that an act which threatens a person's life, which is also explicit, realistic, pornographic, and real? Because I might die at any second. This is a harmful activity. Stop me, someone, please. So again, there's a huge problem with what threatens a person's life. Those of you who've had the misfortune of following me on Twitter or seeing some of my trials will know that in the porn trial, we actually had to call a colorectal surgeon in evidence. To say that anal fisting was not likely to cause serious injury to person's anus, breasts and genitals, which is the second category. Again, I have no idea on what serious injury actually is. It's not defined. There is, funnily enough, an MOJ document which essentially says, that thing we did, these are some words, obscene, right? Not like the Obscene Publications Act, though, which is quite helpful till they archived it. So there are explanatory notes that don't explain this, which have been disappeared from the internet, unless you use sort of Wayback Machine type tools, which I tend to do and judges don't like. So the first two categories there are very, very bizarre because they're so poorly defined. I have no problem with C and D, which for those of you who can't see is basically necrophilia and bestiality. I have no problem with those being criminalised as a matter of settled law. Animals and cadavers cannot consent at law. Have E, which is the very bottom one, so for those of you at the back, I'll read it out. Images depicting non-consensual penetration and rape. Now, this was added very recently by Section 37 of the Criminal Justice Courts Act 2015. So, in other words, there were four, and now essentially rape has been added as a fifth one. Now, again, this may seem like a reasonable prohibition, but the language is so opaque. Images depicting non-consensual penetration and rape. Now, if it was simply images of, I would say, yes, of course. This is absolutely abhorrent material if it's a real film of such an act. But where does that leave people who actually enjoy playing with these concepts, as many BDSM-type practitioners and people in the LGBTQ community do, and many others too? So it's very grey as to what will and won't be acceptable. Again, as Pandora has made very clear, it would seem to me that this not only is unwise, but it deliberately or perhaps unintentionally, but almost certainly prejudices minority communities. So again, BDSM, LGBTQ, etc. Oh, good, a white screen. That actually isn't my Mac crashing. So does anyone know how long I've been in time? Because I feel like I've been forever and no one's asked me a question, which is always frightening. Yes, Wendy, was that you stretching?
It's a complicated question, so
please. Save it for later, Wendy. Save it for later. I know it's going to be a good one.
I was at a conference last week called We Robot,
where... Was that you saving it for later?
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I am serious. Save it for later, and then Pandora and I both do it. Yeah? In summary, really quickly, I wanted to just flag the obvious things of... Pandora's covered them exceptionally well, but incredible intrusion into freedom of expression that this creates, which is likely to disproportionately affect minority communities. The falsehoods on which it was based. So again, the assumption that child protection is an imperative seems entirely reasonable on a cursory glance. But the finer details prove almost the exact opposite. And the utter clusterfuck that is the privacy arrangement or lack thereof and security of that data when it comes to age verification, how the information is actually stored and how individuals are incredibly likely to have their data leaked, hacked, commercialized, stolen or be otherwise embarrassed in a way that the man who kicked the television set while watching Bill Grundy was. So, thank you very much. Let's take some questions, yeah?
Sure.
Cool. You're good.
It's a legal paper workshop where a lot of lawyers get together and imagine the policy conflicts that will arise as robots become ubiquitous. And they do some very interesting smashing ideas together. And one of the papers was written by a researcher named Kristen Thomason, and it was called Feminist Perspectives on Drone Regulation. And her starting point was an article in Slate written by someone named Margot Kaminsky, who is also frequently which called out the fact that in many different countries with respect to drones, we are seeing this narrative appear about the sunbathing teenager whose privacy is invaded by this drone. And of course, the American version, the guy gets out a shotgun and shoots it down. But in other countries, I believe the response has been slightly more moderate, at least physically. But the point she was trying to make in the paper, which is very interesting to look at, is that when you sort of turn a feminist lens on this, you sort of ask, well, you have this focus on the physical safety of women,
yes,
and it's kind of paternalistic, but it completely distracts from the question of informational imbalance and other issues surrounding drone regulation. Everybody just focuses on this, oh my God, this gun made a teenager has been seen by a drone. So my question actually with this is, if this is being built the same way, if we have this narrative appearing in all these countries about the dangers to children of pornography online, what are they distracting us from?
MPs abusing children.
Well, that could be, but...
Do you want to take that, shall I? Oh, thanks. Okay, very, very interesting question. I feel I'm likely to get diverted from the core question of what are we being diverted from? I mean, I think most people in this room would agree with things like the Investigatory Powers Act of surveillance. There's an argument of a slight conflation between the two in terms of a sort of database of porn users. So you can make that argument, I suppose. It's very difficult to say what this... I mean, from my talk, I would suggest that this was presented as a simple, easy, achievable goal, which it has turned out to be anything but. The assumption from the political elite that actually the majority of people would object to this has not been... wouldn't object to this has not necessarily been borne out. Uptake of filter usage, etc., etc. So I think that's possibly more in the area that it was just seen as a simple solution. My concern, obviously, is that it's not provided by the state, but the state is essentially abdicating responsibility by putting it onto the private sector, and as Pandora very acutely identified, the private sector companies may quite well have an interest in monetizing the data that they hold in their back end.
I guess I'm just convinced that there must be something we're not looking at because the same idea that children have to be protected against this terrible thing keeps appearing everywhere.
Well, presumably it's a very simple mean, as Pandora started with the idea of child protection or terrorism.
I mean, my reading of the Lord's debates has revealed that there have been some women, some feminists in both houses who have been campaigning passionately to get all pornography banned, or at the very least age verification put in place, for many, many years. I mean, one of the baronesses who was involved in the debate in the Lords have said that she's been doorstepping David Cameron on this since like 2011. I can email you the name. I don't want to guess and get it wrong. So the way I see this is not so much some conspiracy theory, although I mean, I have observed that the government have been trying to regulate the internet for many, many years and are looking for excuses and ways to do so. And the introduction of a new list of blocked websites at ISP level, which may be extended to be opened to things that aren't online porn by governments in the future, I'm sure is seen as like a valuable means of control by them. But actually, I don't think that's the reason this is a Conservative Party manifesto. I think the reason this is a Conservative Party manifesto is that they were being lobbied by anti-sex work, anti-porn, anti-sex feminists, who are very much in, you know, sold on the cultural argument that pornography is intrinsically linked to the objectification of women, and wants it all banned. I mean, in the Lords, we've had people saying, like, if I could ban all pornography, I would, but I can't, so instead we're going to do this, and it's too little too late, and there's no way this can be enough. So those are the ones who want this, and anyone who's saying, well, hang on a minute, what's the cost, and what's your evidence, and, you know, are you really just saying, well, I don't like it, so it's bad, is up against this very impassioned... I find it personally quite offensive to read because they're talking about violent pornography, and I make violent pornography, you know. I make consensual violent pornography. And when you read the discourse, it's absolutely abundantly evident, as Myles has identified in Clause E of the extreme porn definition, that performer consent is completely erased in the rhetoric. you know, violent porn is talked about as if it was a recording of an assault, like, yeah, ubiquitously across the board. There is absolutely no one, apart from Baroness Jones of Whitchurch, is the only person in either house who in any of the Hands Off transcripts has mentioned the word roleplay. And she has been one of the strongest advocates for amending the worst excesses of the bill, and I thank her for that. But yeah, this idea that people might consent to play kinky games and play pretend and do dressing up and act out consensual violence or simulated violence, which they have the right to do, is completely absent from this bill. And so we've got this conflation of consensual kink with real violent assault. And that is what has made this very easy to get through, because people who aren't in the know wouldn't necessarily know that we're not talking about a video of someone being beaten horrifically and not consenting to it.
We only have to look at United Airlines for that.
Yeah, right. Gentlemen,
can I follow on that? Because it seems that the public good defence has gone. So this depiction of rape could technically criminalise classical painting of the rape of the Sabine women. Because there's no public good defence, which there was under the old obscene public So, correct me if I'm wrong, that seems to have gone.
Well, again, that's not... Your basic premise is strong, but it was under the Obscene Publications Act. There was the Public Good Defence. There still is in the Theatres Act for obscenity on stage. So if you want to do, if we do an obscenity now, we can claim this as a performance. then, more importantly, under the Public Good type defence and art defence, we can actually call expert witnesses to say that it was a rarefied work of art. But the point I was going to make to pick up your class point is this is very easy for a bunch of pseudo-intellectual people in London to claim a public good type argument. What about people who are just cam girls in the Midlands? It's a lot harder in that context. But yeah, the lady in this one, as a single frame, it's harder to argue. But having said that, I ended up representing a gallery in Mayfair who a police officer had gone past on the bus. So they're off duty and they saw a representation of Leda and the Swan, which was really quite good photo reel shot, essentially composite image of a swan flying down onto a woman's recumbent body. But there was no penetration or anything. It was clearly a composite image, etc., etc. And he just off the cuff said that this was extreme pornography and that they should take it out of the window and so on. I think it really boosted the popularity of that gallery for a few months. But again, that wouldn't have worked in that context. But yes.
But does public good defence apply to extreme porn?
No, there is no public good defence in extreme porn. No. There is no specific defence. There is a specific defence, 66, I think, of if you made it.
But what you can say is that it wasn't primarily and solely produced personal sexual arousal. So this was how I successfully won my appeal against Appbot, was that I argued that my site wasn't principally a commercial pornography site because it had loads of blog posts and information and shame-reducing, stigma-reducing kind of fluffy stuff about how it's okay to be kinky as long as everyone consents. And so I was able to spin it as it being a community site and an art project rather than primarily and solely a pornographic site. So you could contest the principally or solely definition. A note on the extraction, because I've been swatting up on the amendments today and this is actually covered.
Yeah.
They do say that on the definition of pornographic material, if it's a part of a greater work, then the greater work is not pornographic. But if the part is extracted primarily or solely from the purposes of sexual arousal, then that extracted part is counted as pornographic material.
Yeah, there's this happened in the debates in the, I think it was the Joint Committee on Human Rights for the extreme pornography legislation, and Gareth Crossman from Liberty put a lot of the points on behalf of Backlash, and one of the illustrations was, okay, so you've got a Bond movie, Casino Royale. Don't know if you've seen it. I'd only actually saw it quite recently myself, but there's a scene where he's the Bond character is on a chair like this, tied up, and his testicles are whipped, right? It's a 12-rated movie. But they pointed out that if you excise the scene of the testicular whipping, that would then become extreme pornography. Hello, philosophy. Someone explain that to me,
but
please.
But only if you put it in a folder on a computer called...
if you recontextualized it, something that was art that was 12 rated, recontextualized, as Pandora says, becomes extreme pornography.
I'm sure you could do the same with many excerpts from Game of Thrones, which is actually the creation of a thought crime.
Yeah.
Because it's not the work itself that's being judged, it's the way in which it's being consumed.
Or thought to be consumed, yeah. Yes, please.
Yeah, sorry, yeah. I've been struggling for years to understand this, why public figures, people like Claire Perry, et cetera, had this need to control and regulate what other people do. And as a result, I'm doing a new article, The Psychology of Censorship, which I'm working on at the moment. Mm. And there's a number of things involved, as we know, patronising, condescending in extreme sense, control, guilt is in there a lot. You know, and if you go around the National Galleries, I has done this afternoon, it's almost a double morality.
Yeah,
you know,
right.
You've got a combination of bestiality, sadomasochism, paedophilia, religiosity. So there's a lot of double morality there as well. But what I'm saying is basically the long-term solution to stop this becoming a war of attrition between ourselves and the government is to have a bill of inalienable rights which protects at what adults do and stops this war of attrition. Because they're going to go back and rewrite a new set of rules. And still, until we've got a set of inalienable rights, and also a lot of this emanates from the Obscene Publications Act. Until we can actually attack that,
Sure. I would actually argue, in theory, I quite like the Obscene Publications Act for one reason and one reason only. So I'm sure all of you know of the deprave and corrupt test, which is the core test in the Obscene Publications Act that must deprave and corrupt people. Now, that is highly subjective and theoretically subject to a jury, so members of broader society randomly picked. And my experience is juries are actually extraordinarily well picked by computer, as it were, because they do really reflect their communities. You go to different crown courts around the country and you see totally different changes in types of people there. But there's a key case from 1982, so it's pre-internet, it's pretty much pre-major uptake of video. It's really a cine-reel period. And it's about sentencing. And it says that the Obscene Publications Act should be interpreted in line with changing moral standards. And ultimately, that's the jury's role to decide. Now, where I would agree with you is where the Crown Prosecution Service have repeatedly refused to update their guidelines on the Obscene Publications Act. So when we had victories with the porn trial and the obscenity trial, which was 2012, and both cases happened to involve male-on-male anal fisting. Now, twice, juries looked at this material and said, we're not bothered by it. By returning a not guilty verdict, they acquitted their duty to be moral arbiters and essentially said, it's okay, I'm not bothered, I may not want to consume this material myself, but I'm perfectly prepared to accept that it exists. And the Crown Prosecution Service, 5 years later, have still not removed fisting, for example, as a category which they say is verboten. So, yes, there are clearly problems in the system. I would argue for root and branch obscenity review, but I appreciate I'm unlikely to receive that, so that we need to be attacking these things case by case.
There's a lovely bit in the Lords debate where we've been campaigning to not have the CPS guidance be the test on this basis, and one of the Lords who hasn't really piped up very much just gets the mic and is like, but why can't CPS just update their guidance? And Lord Paddock, who's currently speaking, goes, well, indeed.
Yeah! yes, please.
I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about the age verification system. You mentioned that MindGeek had put his money into developing this system. Is that something that's specified by the bill? Is there a list of approved verifiers? Or can a third party set up their own verification system?
Yeah. Third parties can set up their own systems. Lord Paddock tabled an amendment, which I think drew heavily from the Open Rights Group's proposed amendment to try and get some clarity on this. But it was actually, I think it was actually voted against. They actually put it to the test.
Yeah.
So it wasn't just shot down by the government, like the Lords voted on it and didn't pass it. MindGeeks won. They're hoping to clean up and extend their monopoly to, so they're no longer just distribution and production, they're now also going to be the gatekeepers of online porn. They estimated, what was it, like, how many hundreds of thousands of people were going to visit Pornhub
and
get on their database, that they were going to be able to basically... I think the phrase for this is regulatory capture, where a corporate vested interest becomes enshrined in law. There's absolutely no list of approved AV providers. Anybody can set up an AV solution and then start collecting data if they want to. Never mind all of the fraudulent websites that are going to pop up pretending to be AV solutions and just actually harvesting people's data. Personally, I'd like to put it out to any hacktivists who are out there that if we could generate an open source AV verification solution that was funded by advertising rather than extracting a fee from the site owner, then we could have a very neat way around this and be able to keep a lot of niche websites open. But I don't have the skills to build it, so I'd just like to sort of throw that idea out for free.
I've got an idea for you.
Invasive age verification or any sort of verification techniques, often called zero knowledge proofs, where the recipient gathers no personally identifiable privacy invading.
Well, the way it's set up is that the site owner, so if I've got AV on my website, I won't see any of the identifying details that are entered by the user. So you come to my website, you give them your mobile phone number for your 18. I never see that. It's not a form on my website. What happens is that the age verification provider receives your mobile phone number, pings your mobile phone contract, gets a yes token, and then sends that yes token to me. So I never see your details, but the AV provider does, and because they're not regulated, there's nothing to stop them collecting it. The only thing that's curtailing their behaviour is they have to conform with the Data Protection Act. But the Data Protection Act is designed for voluntary people giving their data up voluntarily. It's not intended to cover, you know, people being forced to surrender their data.
That changes a little next year with general data protection regulations.
Yeah, yeah.
Consent has to be a much stricter measure than it is under DPO.
Yeah, there's a guidance for the age where public... Alec Muffet from the Open Rights Group has written a kind of forensic deconstruction of the software solutions available, and if you search for him on Medium, you'll find it.
And it's really good.
It's really good.
There's a gentleman at the back.
Oh, if you're not over 18, you just can't look at the website. It just
Do you mean?
If you build
the
system,
is
there reliability?
No. Because it's not, so we suggested, this was an open rights group thing, but we suggested that there should be not only a privacy and security body who are independent of the BBFC, presuming they are the regulator, but that's been rejected routinely. So it would seem there is no real comeback or liability at law for anyone who produces an AV solution that isn't so solvy. So
yeah, the regulator are going to produce some guidance. I think it is going to be the BBFC. I think that's going to be fun.
Well, I don't know if I should say this in public.
Okay, all right, fine. It may not be the BBFC.
Is it a private meeting?
Well, it's being recorded and you can all... But like if Pandora, someone...
Yeah.
Were to form an alternative possible regulator that the BBFC hadn't been formally chosen, Pandora, then we could possibly judicially review the process by which the BBFC were installed. We could probably hold up the process for 3 years.
Yeah, that would be very interesting.
It would be very interesting, wouldn't it, Pandora?
It would.
Anyone else got a question?
Thing in law to say what groups can regulate the AV system.
Yeah.
And there's no kind of liability for getting it wrong. Or,
none.
Could you just have a tick box that says yes, I'm 18?
That's a very good point, but I don't think that the BBFC, as presumed regulator, are allowed to say that that's atrocious.
They're going to have to produce some guidance once this bill is passed and submit it to the Secretary of State for Culture, Media and Sport.
Yeah,
the Secretary, for how they're going to
choose which regulators are, which AV software solutions are viable and which aren't, and I think the secretary's going to have to approve it.
Yeah, but the problem is, of course, that this has all been voted on prior to the solutions.
Right, exactly.
Well, no, it'll be approved. It won't be. There won't be any recourse.
There'll be some guidance, but yeah, it won't but have any teeth.
It is literally yes, no, tick box. Does the Secretary of State accept this system? But there is not an independent body that can say, well, the privacy level needs to be higher, because as Pandora said, the PAS, which I can't remember the number, it's something like PAS 1246 or something, it is an invented standard that they must all adhere to, and it's so woefully low that it's pretty much tick box, as you said. So the Secretary of State really is just endorsing systems rather than interrogating.
And none of them know anything about these systems. They don't know anything about data security. They don't know anything about data privacy. The BBFC don't really know anything about it. So they're going to be drafting guidance on the basis of which they're going to accept AV solutions. And the Secretary, who doesn't know anything about it, is going to be approving that. But no one is actually going to be a techie in that whole conversation about what AV solutions are going to be permitted and what aren't.
And arguably people like MindGeek have no experience of privacy or data protection in the sense of security. So while they have a vested interest, I just remembered Pandora saying when Wendy and a few of us, like Alec Muffer from the Open Rights Group, went to a talk demonstrating the AV solutions, which in ridiculously unfortunate adult industry style was in a gentleman's club of the type that really isn't a gentleman's club. They essentially all agreed that this was a simple standard. I have another point I've totally forgotten. Phil, for me, will you?
about the solutions.
Yeah.
Well, I was amused at the one that looked at your Facebook profile. That's it. I was able to put my Pandora Blake Facebook.
Yeah.
Pandora Blake is not the name on my passport, it's my porn name. But I've got a Pandora Blake Facebook passport, Facebook account, and I entered it into their system and was approved as being over 18.
Oh, that's, I just remembered, that was it. The MindGeek representative at the porn demos of the AV solutions said that they had expected 20 to 25 million adults in the UK to sign up in the first month to their system, because they are a dominant presence. They own 90 or so percent of all of the tube sites globally. So there are the big ones that, like you said, RedTube or whatever. They have very small. That's the major one that they don't own, yeah. Sure. Sorry, that gentleman there, I think.
Talking about the infrastructure and who pays for it in terms of the content blocked on ISPs. And second question to that would be, if I'm running a cafe and I have a wireless hotspot and I happen to be piggybacking off some corporate network that breaks out in Kazakhstan, am I liable if someone looks at something on that? You know?
Right, okay. So
I'll take the second one, I think.
Okay. The ISPs, we're going to be, for ISP blocking to work, the sanction, the ISPs are going to have to be on it and be willing to do whatever the BBFC asks of them. And so the government have been kind of chatting them up and saying, are you going to do this? And the ISPs will say, yeah, of course, government.
Okay.
So,
Not all of them.
Well, I guess I don't know how many they've been talking to. It hasn't been made clear, just the big five.
Yeah,
you know, probably. I mean, if we were to start a small ISP, for example, would we have to do what the BBFC asked of us? I don't know. But in terms of whether a Wi-Fi provider.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps this is a slight step away from your actual question, but one of the things that we've heard repeatedly is the suggestion, and I put it no higher than that, that MindGeek are going to roll out age verification globally. So even though there are blocking orders endorsed in the bill so that sites who repeatedly fail to comply can be blocked by UK ISPs.
Or any site outside the UK that fails to comply once and therefore can't be sanctioned by the UK government.
Yeah. But if MindGeek do this and make age verification mandatory across all of their sites globally, which it seems would be an acute business decision to make, then the vast majority of pornography as it is currently consumed will suddenly become behind age verification. And there are serious implications from their perspective in terms of they already have content, some of which that is perhaps dubious in terms of ownership, but they have an enormous resource to take from. They have your details, as Pandora said, theoretically, through their own age verification solution. So they have an awful lot to play with and an awful lot to win out of this. And if that is correct, and they do that, that will radically change the way that the industry operates in terms of production and consumption.
I mean, to go back to the liability of a Wi-Fi provider, I think the wording of the bill is that this is a law of distribution, not a law of possession.
Yeah.
So if you manage to get hold of porn that without age verifying, you're not going to be criminalised. But if you're distributing and making money from distributing online, then this law is going to affect you. There is a category of ancillary service providers, so anybody who enables or facilitates the distribution of porn is going to be kind of possibly at risk of, if not being criminalised, at least being contacted and saying you need to stop serving, you know, this website.
How would that affect VPN providers then?
Wow.
Because obviously they could be seen to be facilitating.
Yeah.
It's a good question. It's... I mean, you know, the movement to get everyone using a VPN is, of course, at great risk of, you know, VPNs being somehow criminalised themselves.
I mean, that's the easy thing for them, isn't it? Mm. They look for lower loopholes locally, and then they criminalise VPNs. Job done, right? The internet's gone.
Well, and
basically, it is the British. You know, it's the British government's network then, isn't it, really?
Well, they've talked about ancillary service providers in the first instance. And I haven't seen in the debates, I don't know if you did, any talk about VPNs in that capacity. I didn't see that. It doesn't mean it wasn't there.
They were
predominantly talking about services which allow access to pornography, including search engines, because obviously that's the gateway to material, as far as they are concerned. Twitter.
It's defined as like billing providers, like CC Bilbo, Hotel, Epoch, advertisers, like all of the people who advertise on MyGeek sites, and therefore, you know, because the consumers aren't paying them any money, all the ones who fund those websites, and social media sites like Twitter and Tumblr that allow adult content. They had a whole section of debates on Twitter, and it was like, we're not going to try and ban the whole of Twitter. It was like, well, good. But what they're going to do is, basically, if someone complains to the BBFC that a Twitter profile is distributing porn without age verification, because obviously Twitter isn't going to age verify, the BBFC are going to write to Twitter and say, please delete that account, and Twitter are going to, in theory, are going to comply.
Yeah, right.
But let's see.
The other issue in terms of commercial impact is that... sorry, I'm desperate for some water. Have you got any of that? What were we saying? Sorry, we were talking about ancillary service providers. Cheers. Oh, that's better. Yeah, anyway, I forgot my thought. It can't have been too deep. We're about 20 past. I think we should wrap up by 11:30 at the very late. Oh, bless you. Thank you so much. It's going to help me. Unduly. Should we take two, three more questions at the most, if there are, that is.
Could you elaborate more on the ancillary provider?
Sure. So it's essentially considered to be anyone who is facilitating access to pornography. So as Pandora said, Twitter or Tumblr Exactly. So... it's very currently ill-defined.
But they're not liable. The way it's going to work is that, say, my website, if I don't have age verification and I don't have a geo-block, so you can see my website with age verifying, the BBC notices me, then if they write to me and say, please sort this out and I refuse, their next recourse is going to be to write to my server host, to CC Bill, and to anyone else who's enabling and facilitating that website and say, please withdraw services from this website because it's illegal in the UK. And the server host might not, but CC Bill are likely to cover their asses and be like, oh, well, we don't want to be involved in illegal pornography. So that's going to be sort of plan B after asking me nicely.
If I've managed to get really indie service providers who have got my back, then plan C is to find me and plan D is to block the site. So that's the sort of enforcement breakdown that they've laid out. And if the site isn't based in the UK, then we're going to skip straight to step four.
Could you actually, would you not consider moving your site out of the UK or simply geo-blocking the UK?
Yeah, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get this lovely human who is my back-end developer to write a site which detects which country a user is visiting from. And if they're visiting from the UK, redirect them to a lovely PG-13 website saying it sucks to be you right now. Please join the open rights group and get a VPN.
Email your elected representative.
And if they are not visiting from a UK IP address, then they can see my website and they don't have to age verify, because the law is not about websites hosted in the UK, it's about websites visible to UK internet users. But they just know that if a Russian website is serving content to the UK and they write and say, they write to the Russian server host and say, please delete this website, they're not going to hear back. They just know that.
You get a lot of spam email, though.
Yeah, right. Which is why they've got ISP blocking, because they just know that any attempts to wrangle, negotiate, aren't going to actually result in getting the site taken down.
I'd just like to thank that gentleman for the water, because I finally remembered what I was going to say before I dried up, which is very unusual as an advocate and slightly embarrassing, but there you go. FetLife is the key that I was looking for. So we've heard that currently the strategy likely to be used is that a number of very dominant, in terms of number, sites will be targeted in the first instance.
Yeah, the top 100 most visited sites, which apparently don't include many UK sites at all, indeed any.
Yeah, which is interesting of and in itself.
Yeah.
But we've seen that, as Pandora was saying, credit card processing companies seem to be in dialogue with large sites. The one that I mentioned, FetLife, is sort of... could simply be described as a social media site that's the Facebook of kink. But they have been very public in saying that their credit card processing companies have had long conversations with them, which has led them to remove huge, great tracts of material from their site overnight without the consent of the users or anything like that. No discussion whatsoever. So there is a financial censorship mechanism engaged here, which was exactly what Atvod, who had a go at Pandora, did. They just told credit card companies, we don't like this kind of material and you're under a duty to block it. This seems to be happening again. So it's censorship through financial imperative as well, which is concerning.
And there's always been a global movement to do that anyway. I mean, the international regulations of what you can sell and distribute online are simply what Visa and MasterCard will accept payment for. And they've got their own terms of service, which refuse things to do with card sports, kind of snuff, anything to do with blood. So, this is like very popular kind of bone to pick with feminists because it includes menstrual forms, for example. But there's always been this list of things that you can't show and receive Visa or MasterCard billing for. And even before the UK started spinning this in 2013, my site got reviewed by CC Bill, and I had to take down some lovely nerdy LARP porn that I'd made using like rubber swords. We were kind of having a pirate like sword fight using rubber LARP swords, and apparently this is a deadly weapon, and therefore was non-compliant with the Visa and MasterCard regulations, so I had to take it off. So I mean, this kind of international financial censorship has been carrying on for years anyway, but the Visa and MasterCard regulations are a lot more broad and what is permitted than the UK's kind of new definitions
isn't
are.
This just going to promote cryptocurrency into mainstream, because fundamentally, porn makes everything go mainstream.
Sure.
When someone says, oh yeah, we can only buy, the only secure way to buy porn now is through cryptocurrency, or the least insecure way, it's going to put, people are going to be looking that into.
A lot of pornographers aren't that technically competent, though. I'm certainly not. I didn't know how to take bitcoins on my website.
We're nearly out of time, I think.
Okay.
But does anyone have a light question that we can finish for the proverbial big finish? I was about to say, but something a bit lighter to leaven the mood.
Well,
I think Pandora mentioned Russia. Russia has blocked Pornhub, so don't go to Russia.
All right.
Okay, travel advice, useful. does anyone have something a bit lighter to give us a final leaving moment?
Yeah, it might be an end climax, but yeah, so just a comment basically, followed by a little question. Basically, part of the reason the RA scene that's sort of taken about 15 years came around was camp organisations like the CAC campaign, and basically,
sure.
The law was becoming irrelevant, so they put out R18 because at least they'd have some control, but they're still quite tight. But my question is this, has there been any complaints from the ISPs themselves? I know that Mozilla Firefox are quite consumer friendly, they let us use their building last year. But the other one is, I'm sure there's going to be enormous pressures on Yahoo and Google to do all this nonsense. And has there been any complaints from them, or are they just like little subservient lapdogs that will do whatever the government tells them?
Tax. There was an interesting article, I forget where it was, probably The Guardian, but saying that, when Amber Rudd called in the tech companies, it was a very convenient appearance of a debate that they could have, telling them how bad they were and how they must comply, and they could present the image of subservience while avoiding the issues of sort of tax and interjurisdictional issues and so on. So it's very difficult to realistically estimate that, but I have a feeling that those vested interests are less servile than they would perhaps suggest, shall we say.
Yahoo is actually shortly going to belong to Verizon anyway.
Right, sure.
What I was imagining, though, was the help desk inside ISPs.
I know, right?
That's why they can't get to X.
It's not like I'm the help desk for all the perverts or anything, but one of my friends called me out of the blue and just went, this site I used to look at on the internet's gone. And I'm like, is this why you're calling me while I'm in court, Tony? And he was like, yeah, mate, where's it gone? And I'm like, I gave him a very... And he was like, yeah, I thought you'd be the person to ask. So, yes, I might get inundated with those calls. But I do like the idea of essentially 90% of the pornography on the internet disappearing overnight with some kind of mythical off button and suddenly people going, wait a minute, that's... bad. But we'll see. We will see. Until the enforcement date, it's very speculative. So
which is going to be spring 2018, they're intending to introduce the system by. So
perhaps it'll coincide nicely with some of the Brexit negotiations.
Yeah, right.
Could fall the government there. I mean, you know, people don't care about much, but there's one thing people care about.
It's a free speech issue that is identifiable to people who would not necessarily consider themselves to be freedom of expression people.
The question is how many of them will be willing to call up and complain with their names, you know?
Calling up on behalf of one of their friends.
Yeah, yeah. Hashtag asking for a friend. Yeah.
25,000 people have already signed the petition.
Yeah, sure, exactly.
Which has been presented by the culture.
You good? Great. Thank you very much. Okay.